Thanks. Great to be here. Thank you. Thank you. This is a treat. Janja, thank you so much for making this possible. I'm really happy to be here. So I'm going to talk about my book, Thank You for Being Late, An Optimist's Guide to Thriving in the Age of Accelerations. I'll talk for about 40 minutes, and then we'll open it to Q&A if your bosses will let you stay. Thank You for Being Late. The first question I always get is, where does the title come from? And the title actually comes from meeting people for breakfast in Washington, D.C., where I live over the years. And every once in a while, someone would come 10, 15, 20 minutes late. And they say, Tom, I'm really sorry. Is the weather, the traffic, the subway, the dog ate my homework? And one day, about 3 years ago, one of them, Peter Corsell, he's an energy entrepreneur, came late to where I live in D.C. to the hotel and did that. I'm really sorry, weather, the traffic, the subway. And I said spontaneously, actually, Peter, thank you for being late. Because you were late, I've been eavesdropping on their conversation. Fascinating. I've been people watching the lobby. Fantastic. And best of all, I just connected two ideas I've been struggling with for a month. So thank you for being late. People started to get into it. They'd say, well, you're welcome. Because they understood I was actually giving them permission to pause, to slow down, to reflect. In fact, my favorite quote in the front of the book is from my teacher and friend, Dove Seidman, who says, you know, when you press the pause button on a computer, it stops. But when you press the pause button on a human being, it starts. That's when it starts to reflect, rethink, and reimagine. And boy, don't we need to do a lot of that right now. So the book actually was triggered when I paused and engaged with someone I wouldn't normally engage with. I live in Bethesda, Maryland, outside of Washington, and I take the subway to work to the Washington office of the New York Times about once a week. And for me, it involves driving from my home in Bethesda to the Bethesda Hyatt Hotel, and I park in the public parking garage, beneath the Hyatt, and I take the red line into D.C. Just grab this water, yeah, just for a quick second. So I did that. I go to my office, take the red line back, get my car, have my timestamp ticket, drive to the cashier's booth, give the cashier my ticket. He looks at it, looks at me, and says, I know who you are. I said, great. He said, I read your column. I said, great. He said, I don't always agree. I thought, get me out of here. but I actually said, well, that's good, because that means you have to always check. And then I drove off and thought, kind of nice that the cashier at the parking lot reads my column. A week later, I took my weekly trip into D.C., red line in, office, red line back, car, timestamp ticket, same guys in the cashier booth. And this time he says, Mr. Friedman, I have my own blog. Would you read my blog? I thought, oh my God, the parking guy is now my competitor? What just happened? So I said, well, write it down for me and I'll look it up. So he wrote down on a piece of his torn receipt paper, odenambi.com. I went home, I called it up. Turns out he's Ethiopian, writes about Ethiopian politics from a very pro-democracy point of view, from the Oromo people. Told my wife about it. I thought about him for a couple days and I decided this was a sign from God. I should pause and engage this guy. But he didn't have his email. So the only way I could do it was park in the parking garage every day. And I did that for, I don't remember now, 4 or 5 days. We finally overlapped at 7 a.m. in the morning. I stopped under the gate so it couldn't come down. I got out of my car and I said, Ayile, now I know his name. Ayile, I would like your email. I want to send you a message. He gladly gave it to me. And that night I began an email exchange with him, which is in the front of the book, in which I basically said to him, I have a proposition for you. I will teach you how to write a column if you will tell me your life story. And he basically responded, I see you're proposing a deal. I like this deal. he asked if we could meet near his office at Pete's Coffee House in Bethesda. And we arranged for that 2 weeks later. And to make a long story short, I basically came with a 6-page memo on how to write a column. If the world is a big data set, this is my algorithm. And he came with his life story. Ethiopian immigrant, a democracy advocate, basically got thrown out of Ethiopia, became a political exile in the States, was blogging on Ethiopian websites. But they were too slow, Mr. Friedman. They wouldn't turn my stuff around fast enough. So he decided to start his own blog, and now I feel empowered. His Google metrics, he knows his Google metrics, tell him he's read in 30 different countries. It's my parking guy. It's a wonderful story about the ability of anyone today to participate in the global conversation. And we met there in Pete's Coffee House as two colleagues, in a way, two columnists trying to figure it out. And we've become friends, and he's a wonderful person. I then explained to him how I write a column. And I explained to him that a news story is meant to inform. I could write a news story about this gathering here, and Yanju would tell me later whether I inform better or worse. But a column, an opinion piece, is meant to provoke. So I'm either in the heating business or the lighting business. I'm either doing a heating or a lighting, okay? I'm either stoking up an emotion in you, or I'm illuminating something for you, or ideally I do both, and I produce either heat or light or both. But I explained to him that to produce heat and light requires actually mixing three chemicals. The first is, what is your value set? What are the set of values you're trying to push into the world? Are you a communist, a capitalist, a neocon, a neoliberal, a libertarian, a Keynesian, a Marxist? What is the value set you're pushing? Second, how do you think the machine works? So the machine is my shorthand for what are the biggest forces shaping more things in more ways, in more places, on more days? How do the gears and pulleys of the world work? Because I think as a columnist, you always need to have a working hypothesis of how the machine works, because what you're trying to do is take your values and push the machine, and if you don't know how it works, you'll either not push it, or you'll push it in the wrong direction. And lastly, what have you learned about people and culture? Because there's no column without people, there are no people without culture, and how the machine affects people, and how they come back and affect the machine. Stir those three together, let it rise, bake for 45 minutes, and if you do it right, you'll produce a column that produces heat or light. And you'll know it by the reactions you get from your readers. Some might say, I didn't know that when they read your column. It's a good reaction. You produce light. I never looked at it that way. That's a good reaction. I never connected those things. That's a real good reaction. Your favorite, you live for this, happens four times a year. Mr. Friedman, you said exactly what I felt, but didn't know how to say. God bless you. I want to kill you dead, you and all your offspring. That's another reaction I get. That tells you you've produced a heat or light. Anyways, the more I explained this to Yili, we had several sessions and email exchanges, the more I sat back and started to say to myself, well, if that's what a column's about, what's my politics? What's my value set? Those of you who follow me, you know, I have a rather quirky set of values. I'm not quite a liberal. I'm certainly not a conservative. I mix a lot of things together because my politics actually doesn't emerge from a library or a philosopher, but emerges from the small town in Minnesota where I grew up. How do I think the machine works today? And what have I learned about people and culture? And I decided that's the book I wanted to write. And that's what the book is about. So the first half is about how the machine works. And the second half is about how the machine is reshaping five realms: politics, geopolitics, ethics, the workplace, and community. So my just short version of how the machine works today is, I think what's shaping more things in more ways and more places on more days is we're in the middle of three nonlinear accelerations all at the same time with the three largest forces on the planet, which I call the market, Mother Nature, and Moore's Law. So the market for me is globalization, but not your grandfather's globalization. That was containers on ships. It's the globalization you all are involved in, digital globalization. The way everything now is being digitized and globalized through Google, Facebook, Twitter, PayPal, MOOCs, whatever it is. If you measured it on a graph, it would look like a hockey stick. Mother Nature for me is biodiversity loss, climate change, and population growth. If you put it on a graph, it looks like a hockey stick. And Moore's Law, of course, coined by Gordon Moore, the co-founder of Intel in 1965, posited that the speed and power of microchips would double roughly every 24 months. And that's held up. It's closer to 30 months, but never mind. It's held up for 52 years. And anyone who tells you Moore's Law is running out, actually someone almost once a year writes that Moore's Law is about to run out. You can set your watch by it. And what they all have in common is one thing, they were all wrong, okay? So we're in the middle of three exponential accelerations all at the same time, and they're all bouncing off each other. Because more Moore's Law drives more digital globalization drives more climate change, and more solutions as well. And I think these three accelerations, as I said, aren't just changing the world, they're reshaping some very fundamental things. But the hardest thing for the human mind to grasp is the power of an exponential, which is why it's very hard for us to understand what's going on right now. So I'll just talk about the Moore's Law exponential, the Mother Nature and the market. I'll leave for those of you who get a chance to read the book. Intel's engineers to try to explain to people once the power of the exponential of microchips doubling every 24 months, once did a back of the envelope calculation just for fun. They said, what if a 1971 VW Beetle improved at the same rate microchips had? And they estimated that today that Beetle would go 300,000 miles an hour, it would get 2 million miles per gallon, and it would cost 4 cents, okay? So that's the power of doubling and doubling and doubling and doubling. Now my chapter on this is called What the Hell Happened in 2007. 2007, what's this guy talking about? This innocuous year, 2007. Well, here's what happened in 2007. The year kicked off at the Moscone Center in San Francisco when one Steve Jobs introduced something called the iPhone, beginning a process by we are now putting into the hands, we've probably got to half the people on the planet, heading for all 7.2 billion, a handheld phone with the compute power of the Apollo space mission connected to the internet. That's how the year kicked off, but that was 2007 just clearing its throat. Because also in 2007, a company called Facebook, which had been confined to college campuses and universities, opened its platform actually in late 2006 to anyone with a registered email address. And in 2007, it went global. The same year, a company called Twitter split off on its own platform and also went global. The same year, the most important open source software, I usually say you've never heard of, but people here will have heard of it, called Hadoop, named after the founder's son's toy elephant, launched itself into the wild. And Hadoop, of course, is what enables a million computers to work together as one and creates the foundation of big data. Now, its innovations actually came from Google, MapReduce, and GFS. And as Doug Cutting, the founder of Hadoop, explains in the book, Google lives in the future and sends us letters home. And what it did was basically leave a trail of breadcrumbs from MapReduce back to the open source community. They reverse engineered it and created an open source version for big data. And that's really was the foundation of that scaling around the world. In 2007, the second most important software company most people haven't heard of, called GitHub, opened its doors, creating the world's now largest repository of open source software. In 2007, a company called Google bought a little known TV company called YouTube. And in 2007, this same company called Google launched into the wild its own operating system called Android. In 2007, a guy up in Seattle named Jeff Bezos launched the world's first ebook reader called the Kindle. In 2007, IBM launched the world's first cognitive computer called Watson. In 2007, three design students in San Francisco who were attending the design conference that year discovered all the hotel rooms were sold out and people were still looking for rooms, and one of them had three spare air mattresses. And they thought it might be cool to rent those out to people looking for a room, and it worked out so well, they started in 2007 a company called Airbnb. In 2007, late 2006, the internet crossed for the first time 1 billion users. What else happened in 2007? Excuse me, I got a few slides here. Oh, yeah, yeah, sequencing the human genome. Let's see. In 2001, it was $100 million to sequence a human genome. It basically fell around 2006 to $10 million, and then it goes over a cliff down to $1,200 in what year? 2007. Solar power took off in 2007. This is actually the world of Google in many ways. This is, and Facebook, this is the cost of generating a megabit of data. That's the white line. It goes straight down in 2007. And then this is the speed at which you can transmit that megabit of data, and it begins to soar, and the two lines cross in 2008. That's close enough for government work. That's Moore's Law. Oh, yes, I forgot. The cloud was launched in 2007. The cloud as we know it. The first numbers appear in 2008. In 2007, Intel, for the first time, went off silicon, introduced non-silicon materials into its transistors to extend the Moore's Law exponential for another decade. Turns out, friends, 2007 may be understood in time as the single greatest technological inflection point since Gutenberg. And we completely missed it because of 2008. So think about what happens. Right when the world, it's like we're on a moving sidewalk at Heathrow, and that moving sidewalk, our physical technologies just launch. It goes from 5 miles to 50 miles an hour, and we're all feeling that sense of acceleration, the ground moving under our feet. Right when that happens, our social technologies, all the things you'd want to go with that, the reform, the political reengineering, the regulatory changes, the political reforms, they all freeze because the world enters the biggest recession since 1929. And we are still living in that dislocation because there's a lot of people who got dislocated at that moment. And Brexit and Trump are not unrelated to that fact. So, God, that's really cool. I can actually tell this story, Anja. So I'm out at Google X, and I'm talking to Astro Teller, and I'm testing these ideas on Astro. And so he goes over to his whiteboard, and he draws this graph. I said, "What's that?" He said, "The blue line is the average rate at which human beings and societies adapt to change over time. So it has a positive slope, but it's very gradual. The white line, obviously this is just a crude rendering, is technology. We'll call that Moore's Law. So if you lived in the 11th century or the 12th century, your life, your bow and arrow didn't get better over a whole century, okay? But then we get Copernicus and Galileo and Intel, and the line goes straight north. And then Astro went over and drew this little diamond here, and he wrote the words, we are here. We're at a place now where technology is simply changing faster than the average human being and society can adapt. So algorithms, machines, robots are now changing 2 to 3 years, and just to get a patent today can take 4 to 5. So there's a complete mismatch. So then he went over, he got another magic marker, and he drew this dotted line. And I said, "What's that?" He said, "That's learning faster and governing smarter. How do we lift this blue line to meet people, to enable more people to meet technology where it is?" And it's a lot of what you all are doing, I think. So what actually happened in 2007? Well, I think what happened, and this I frame it in the book, is your computer is actually made of 5 key components: the CPU, the microchip, processor, a storage chip, networking, software, and a sensor. And I basically tell the evolution of all 5. And I think what happened is basically they're all in a Moore's Law. And in 2007, they all melded into this thing we call the cloud. The cloud. But I never use the term the cloud in my book because it sounds so soft, so fluffy, so benign. Sounds like a Joni Mitchell song. I've looked at clouds from both sides. This ain't no cloud, folks. I rename it in the book the supernova because a supernova is the largest force in nature. It's the explosion of a star. And I think this is an ever-accelerating supernova. Because what happened when all of these things melded together, basically, was an incredible release of energy into the hands of human beings and machines. And it changed 4 kinds of power in the early 21st century. It first changed the power of one. Wow, what one person can do now has been incredibly amplified. We have a president who can sit in his pajamas, get on his cell phone, and tweet directly now without an editor, a libel lawyer, or a filter. I'm not going there, okay? This is, that's right. Some would say without a brain. directly to hundreds of millions of people around the world. But that's actually not what's so amazing. What's amazing is that the head of ISIS can do the exact same thing from Raqqa province. So whether you are a maker or a breaker today, your power has been amplified. Power machines have been amplified. Machines now have all five senses. And Google's at, with DeepMind, is at the forefront of that. I would say that line was crossed for the first time on February 14th, 2011, on all places, a game show. There were three contestants. Two were the all-time Jeopardy champions, and the third simply went by his last name, Watson. Mr. Watson passed on the first question. He then buzzed in before the two humans on the second question. The question was, it's worn on the foot of a horse and used by a dealer in a casino. And in under 2.5 seconds, Mr. Watson said in perfect Jeopardy voice, what is a shoe? And for the first time, a cognitive computer solved a pun before two human beings. And the world kind of hasn't been the same since. It's changed the power of flows. Ideas now flow and circulate, thanks in part to Google, at a speed we've never seen before. Barack Obama 5 years ago said marriage is between a man and a woman, just 5 years ago. Today, blessedly so, he says marriage is between any two human beings who love each other, and he is following Ireland in that position. A year and a half ago, a terrible person, Dylan Roof, went into a black church in South Carolina and shot it up and killed nine African-American kids. In South Carolina, that he had posed on his Facebook page with a Confederate flag. The Confederate flag has flown over the State House of South Carolina for, I believe, some 75 years. Thanks to social networks in the reaction to that, the flag was gone in a week. Ideas now flow and melt and change at a speed we've never seen before. And it's changed the power of many. Because when you get machines and people this amplified, we become the most forcing function on nature. Which is why the new geophysical era is being named for us, the Anthropocene. So these four changes in power are what's reshaping the world. Second half of the book is about those reshaping. Let me just go through a couple of them. The first is how the workplace is being reshaped. And my chapter on that is called How We Turn AI into IA. How do we turn artificial intelligence into intelligent assistance, A-N-C-E, intelligent assistance, A-N-T-S, and intelligent algorithms so more workers can get on that upward slope? I think that's the central political, social, and economic challenge of politics today, if we don't figure out a way to do that. What I found in working on the book is that there's actually amazing amount of innovation and entrepreneurship on that challenge. And I give an example of each one of these. Intelligent assistance, my example is the human resources department at AT&T. Big company, 360,000 employees, living next to the supernova, competing with Verizon and Sprint and Deutsche Telekom and BT every day. Pretty good chance what they're doing in HR is going to come to a neighborhood near you. So here's their HR policy in real short. Basically, Randall Stephenson, their CEO, begins the year now with a radically transparent speech about where the company is going, how they see their markets, and what skills you need to be an employee that year at AT&T. Then they put every employee on their own in-house LinkedIn system. So they got Yanja there. And it turns out they have 10 skills they think you need to be an employee at AT&T that year. And Yanja has 7 of them, but she's missing 3. Then they partnered with Sebastian Thrun from Udacity and created nano degrees for all 10. Then they came to Yanja and said, Yanja, here's the deal. We'll give you up to $8,500 a year to take the courses that we're providing to fill out the skill set you need to be an employee at AT&T. And by the way, we know you like history. If you're into taking an archaeology course, we'll pay for that as well. In fact, if you're interested in computer science, we'll also pay for a one-year master's degree online from Georgia Tech. We created that degree, too, with Udacity. There's just one catch, Yanja. You have to take all these courses on your own time. Now, Yanja may say, you know, I've climbed up one too many telephone poles, and I just don't want to do that anymore. In which case, they now have a wonderful severance package for Yanja, but Yanja will not be working much longer at AT&T. The basic social contract they have with her is that if she takes those courses, they will offer her the new jobs first. They won't go outside. Their basic social contract with Yanja is that you can be a lifelong employee at AT&T, but now only if you're a lifelong learner. And if you are not ready to be a lifelong learner, you can no longer be a lifelong employee at AT&T. And that is the social contract coming to a neighborhood near you. And intelligent assistance is their way of partnering around that. Intelligent assistant, A-N-T, my example is Qualcomm, another company many people haven't heard of. They actually made the inside of your phone, a lot of the software and hardware. They have a 64-building campus in San Diego. I spent a lot of time with them on the book. 2 years ago, they took six of those buildings, I think it was, and they put sensors all over them. Every door, window, HVAC system, faucet, drain, computer, pipe. They take all the data and they beam it up to the supernova, and now they beam it down to an iPad for their janitors. Oh, so if Yanja leaves her computer on or the pipe bursts overhead, they know it before she does, and they can swipe down and find out where to go to repair it or have the instruction manual right there. They've turned their janitors into maintenance technologists. Their janitors now give tours to foreign visitors. What do you suppose that does for the dignity of a janitor? Because he or she now has an intelligent assistant enabling them to live above the line. Intelligent algorithm, I have two examples of that. One is partnership that was created 3 years ago by the College Board, which administers our PSAT and SAT exams, our equivalent of A-levels and O-levels, to determine whether you can get into college, and the Khan Academy online learning platform. So basically, those of you Americans know this, those of you don't, in 11th grade of high school, Americans have to take the PSAT, the practice SAT exam, to prepare them to take the SAT exam to determine their math and verbal skills and whether they get into the college they want. If you're a neurotic suburban parent like we are, myself and my wife, what you actually do is go out and hire a tutor for $200 an hour to goose your kids' scores up on math and verbal. Don't worry, we all did it. You don't have to be embarrassed. A completely rigged game. A completely rigged game. Because if you come from a family or a neighborhood where you don't know you can even do this, let alone be able to afford it, you're at a real disadvantage. 2 years ago, I said 3 years ago, they started, Sal Khan and the College Board partnered to create a platform, an intelligent algorithm for free PSAT and SAT prep. Now the way it works, I'm going to use my friend Yanja again. Yanja takes the PSAT in 11th grade. She gets the results back. It says, Yanja, you did very well. You did very well, but you do have a problem with fractions and right angles. It then takes Yanja to a practice site just for fractions and right angles, targeted exactly to her weaknesses. Doesn't spend any waste any time on her strength. If she does well there, comes back and says, John, do you realize you could take AP Math? You could take Advanced Placement Math? Maybe she comes from a family never heard of AP Math in 12th grade. Takes her to another site with 180 college scholarships and another site that partners her with young men and women from the Boys and Girls Clubs of America to help her through this process. That is an intelligent algorithm. Last year, 2 million American kids availed themselves of free PSAT and SAT prep on that platform. Last one is opportunity at work. We have about 32 million Americans who started college but never finished. Some captured 1 year of learning, 2 years, 2.5, three and a half years and dropped out. They go to apply for a job. Boss says, where's your BA? Where's your badge? Say, I don't have one. Say goodbye. So a year and a half ago, a group of friends of mine started something called Opportunity at Work. Now you come to them. You went to college for 2.5 years. They measure exactly what you learned, the knowledge you captured. They turn it into a badge, and they partner with companies to insert you in basically horizontally at exactly your level. Because companies know you learn something. They really don't care what you know, they care what you could do with what you know. And now we're taking all of these people who dropped out but weren't badged and inserting them into the workforce. I profile a young African-American woman who went to Michigan Tech, dropped out after 3.5 years in computer science, had no BA, was basically driving, you couldn't make this up, the exact story's in the book, but she was driving, I believe, the school bus to a computer college. Then she worked on the help desk at a law firm, helping knucklehead lawyers figure out how to redo their passwords. She was connected with Opportunity at Work, is actually a different parallel one, which I don't have the name offhand, who captured her knowledge, got her hired by MasterCard, and today she is a systems engineer at MasterCard, and her last line of the interview is, "And I still don't have my BA." Now I'm gonna bet something. I'm gonna bet that none of you have ever heard of any of this. That's because you were paying attention to our last election, where Bernie Sanders' big idea to help jobs was to tear down the big banks. Donald Trump's big idea was to tear down Hillary Clinton. And Hillary Clinton's big idea was to direct you to her website, okay? www.hillaryclinton.com. What is the real story here? The real story is there's actually massive innovation going on around the pipeline of education to work, and nobody is telling anybody. There's actually massive innovation going on there. And you would never know it if you listened to Donald Trump's Carnage is Us inauguration speech. I'll talk real quickly about another of these realms, and then we can go to questions. I said there are five realms that are being reshaped. One of them is ethics. So you're probably thinking, ethics? Like, I work at Google. What do we need to think about ethics for, okay? I'm in tech. So here's how the ethics realm is being reshaped. My chapter on that is called Is God in Cyberspace? It comes from the best question I ever got on book tour. I'm in Portland, Oregon in 1999 selling a book called Lexus and the Olive Tree. Man stands up in the balcony in question time and says, "Mr. Friedman, I have a question. Is God in cyberspace?" I thought, I have no idea. I felt like a complete idiot. I got home, I called one of my spiritual teachers. He's a rabbi I met when I was the New York Times correspondent in Jerusalem, a great Talmudic scholar, Zvi Marks. He lives in Amsterdam, married to a Dutch priest, very interesting guy. I called him in Amsterdam. I said, "Zvi, I got a question I have never had before. Is God in cyberspace? What should I have said?" And he said, "Well, Tom, in our faith tradition, we actually have two concepts of the Almighty, a biblical and a post-biblical concept. The biblical concept is the Almighty's almighty. He smites evil and rewards good. And if that's your view of God, he sure isn't in cyberspace, which is full of pornography, gambling, cheating, lying, prevarication, cybercrime, and now we know fake news, okay?" But he says, "Fortunately, we have a post-biblical view of God. And the post-biblical view of God is that God manifests himself by how we behave. So if we want God to be in cyberspace, we've got to bring him there by how we behave there." Well, I loved his answer. I wrote it all down. I put it into the paperback edition of Lexus and the Olive Tree. Came out around 2000 where none of you saw it and basically forgot about it. I started writing this book and I found myself retelling that story. And I finally sat myself down and said, "Why are you retelling that story?" And it immediately became obvious to me for two reasons. One is our lives, and this year may be seen as the tipping point, we are now living a significant portion of our lives in cyberspace. It's now where we find a date, where we find a spouse, where we do our business, where we get our education, where we get our news, share our news. But what does that mean? It means we're living a significant portion of our lives in a realm where we're all connected, but nobody's in charge. There's no courts in cyberspace, no stoplights, no police, no 1-800, "Please stop Putin from hacking me." Okay? We're living our lives in a realm where we're all connected, but no one's in charge. We're living our lives in a realm that is essentially God-free. And at the same time, because of these accelerations, individual power is being amplified to such a degree that we have now entered a moral intersection we have never stood at before as a human species. We are now living in a world, well, post 1945. In 1945, we entered a world where one country could kill all of us post Hiroshima. If it had to be one country, I'm glad it was mine. I think we're entering a world where one person can kill all of us, and where all of us could also fix everything. These same amplified powers in a hyper-connected world are enabling one of us to kill all of us, and all of us to actually feed, house, clothe, and educate every person on the planet. We have never been to this intersection before, where one of us can kill all of us, and all of us could actually fix everything. What does that mean? It means we've actually never been more godlike as a species. And what does that mean? It means we're now living our lives in a realm that's God-free, and we ourselves have never been more godlike. And when that happens, boy, everybody better have the golden rule. Do unto others as you wish them to do unto you, because we now live in a world where we can do unto others farther, faster, deeper, cheaper than ever before, and they can do unto us farther, faster, deeper, cheaper than ever before as individuals. Vladimir Putin did unto us in America. Where does the golden rule come from? Well, first let me just ask the question I get asked most. Isn't that kind of naive? Everybody gets the golden rule? I actually gave this part of my talk as the commencement address at Olin College of Engineering last May. And I said to the parents, I know what you're thinking, because I know what you're thinking. I said to them, you paid 200 grand so your kid could get an engineering degree. And they brought a knucklehead commencement speaker in who's advocating the golden rule. Is there anything more naive? To which I said to them, naivete is the new realism. Because what's really naive is thinking we're going to be okay when we're now living our lives in a realm that's God-free. And we are more than ever God-like, and everybody doesn't embrace the golden rule. And that is how ethics are being reshaped by the world that you all are participating in. Where does the golden rule come from? It comes from two places, basically. I think strong families and healthy communities. That's where you learn to do unto others as you wish them to do unto you. I'm not an expert on strong families. I hope I built one, but I would never presume to lecture anyone on that. But I am an expert on healthy communities, because I grew up in one, a small suburb slash town of Minneapolis called St. Louis Park. And the book ends, therefore, in the community I grew up in. Short story, very quickly. The Jewish community in Minneapolis, when my parents were born there, lived in a ghetto on the north side of the city with African Americans, not because they were integrated there, but because they were both isolated there. Minneapolis was the capital of anti-Semitism in America in the 1940s. My parents couldn't join the automobile club. And until Hubert Humphrey became mayor of the city in the 40s and cleaned it up. In the mid-50s, after the war, I was born in 53. After the war, all the Jews in the north side of Minneapolis move out almost entirely to one town, the one that did not have restricted covenants, so they could move there and had a housing stock able to take them. So my aunt and uncle moved two doors down one way, my other uncle moved the other door down. A suburb that had been 100% white, Protestant, Catholic, Scandinavian, overnight becomes 20% Jewish, 80% white, Protestant, Catholic, Scandinavian. If Israel and Sweden had a baby, it would be St. Louis Park, okay, my little town. And I tell the story of how these two cultures met and built an inclusive community. And it was not always easy. It was struggle. There were broken dates and broken hearts and whatever. But we all got to get to know each other. And I tell the story of my high school because it was kind of a freaky place because I went to school with or grew up in the same neighborhood with the Cohn brothers, Al Franken, Norman Ornstein, Michael Sandel, the philosopher, Sharon Isbin, the guitarist, Dan Wilson, who wrote Someone Like You with Adele, Peggy Ornstein, Alan Wiseman, we've got our own Wikipedia page. It was a freaky place, okay? This was not a suburb, a neighborhood in the Upper West Side of New York. It was a one high school town in Minnesota. The Coen Brothers movie, A Serious Man, was about our neighborhood. If you watched No Country for Old Men, there's a scene in Mexico where Churga blows up a car outside of a pharmacy in order to distract them so he can go in and steal drugs. The camera pans to the pharmacy, and it's called Mike Zoss Drugs. That was our neighborhood drugstore. So I tell the story about this place and how we built a nice community, an inclusive community. In fact, there's this thing called Minnesota Nice, which I hope I'm a product of. I tell the story. I was home for a wedding for one of my friends while I was writing the book, and my closest friends are still the people I grew up with, so I go home a lot. And one of them, my friend Jay Goldberg, came and said his wife Eileen, we'd all grown up together, had been on the ring road around Minneapolis that day, which is a freeway, and a driver, he said, almost drove her off the road. And she came home and said to Jay, I was so mad, I almost honked. That's Minnesota for road rage, okay. In fact, I tell the story, growing up, there was a Jewish mafia in Minnesota, and my dad knew a lot of these guys. He wasn't, I swear, in the mafia, but he knew a lot of them. And when I was a very young man, I think he was 4 or 5 years old, one of his friends was arrested and sent to jail. And like, I still remember this to this day because it was just freaked me out that my dad knew someone who went to jail. And I asked him one day what he did. And he said, he was shopping in a store before it was open. That's Minnesota for breaking and entering, okay? So anyways, I tell the story of this community. And then the last chapter is I come back 40 years later. I left Minnesota in 1971 to discover the world. And I come back 40 years later to find that the world has discovered St. Louis Park. Now my high school is 50% white Protestant Catholic, it's 10% Jewish, 10% Hispanic, and now 30% Somali. Somali and African American, basically. Now how are they doing? Well, they got a much deeper inclusion challenge now. The span they have to bridge religiously and racially is not just a bunch of white Judeo-Christians. And I tell the story of how they're doing. And it's a struggle, but they're doing pretty well. Not perfect, but they're really struggling with it. And ain't that the struggle of America? And ain't that the struggle of the world? This inclusion challenge. My friend Namry Lovins, the physicist who helped me with all the science in the book, likes to say whenever people ask him, Namry, are you an optimist or a pessimist? He always says, I'm neither, because they're just two different forms of fatalism. Everything will be great. Everything will be awful. Namry says, I believe in applied hope. I believe in applied hope. And I like that phrase, because when I went home to Minnesota, what makes me an optimist is it's not that the challenges are small or that they've all been met. It's the number of people who want to get caught trying. It's the number of people who want to apply hope. If you want to be an optimist about America today, stand on your head, because the country looks so much better from the bottom up than from the top down. And so that's why my book has a theme song, and I will end with my theme song. I thought, could I buy this? And so you open the book up and play this song like a Hallmark card plays Happy Birthday. And the song is called The I, E-Y-E. It's by my favorite country folk singer, Brandi Carlile. And the main refrain is, I wrapped your love around me like a chain, but I never was afraid that it would die. You can dance in a hurricane, but only if you're standing in the eye. I think my three accelerations, they're like a hurricane. I think we have a president who's trying to build a wall against the hurricane. And what I'm advocating for is an eye that moves with the storm, draws energy from it, but creates a platform of dynamic stability within it, the healthy community, where people can feel connected, protected, and respected. I think the struggle in the West, maybe all over the world, in the industrialized countries, going forward, is going to be between the wall people and the eye people. And my book is a manifesto for the eye people. Thank you very much. Thank you. I was actually working on the book, and I am so old-fashioned that I have Sirius Radio, and the only channel I listen to is called Coffee House, which is acoustic guitar. And I was driving, and I heard this song, and I immediately pulled off the road as soon as I could to write down who wrote it and who sang it. And it became the anthem of my book. So that's the backstory. Thanks for getting that, Yanji. We have something. Anyone have a question before we? Yeah, please. Yeah.
Sorry.
Tell me who you are and what you do.
I'm Mike, mm-hmm. and I'm one of those people who works with all the data. Mm-hmm. So I had a question, sort of going back to the beginning of your talk, where you talked about these seismic technology changes. So a lot of people are thinking that the implications of the blockchain and how that could change our society, not only beyond the ability to maybe cut out the banks, but also the ability to transact on trust.
Right.
And I was wondering if you had any thoughts about how you think that would impact our society going forward.
That's a really good question. I have a little on blockchain in my globalization chapter as one of the engines of how data and technology are now making the world more interdependent. But unfortunately, my book spans so many things that I knew I had to have it in there. And I had just enough to show people that I thought about it, but not enough to have a strong opinion about it, because it was like too soon, and it would have taken me a month to figure it all out. So so unfortunately, I can't give you a really intelligent answer.
Okay.
Yeah, please.
I'll repeat it back into the mic.
I'm Alex, I'm SMB marketing.
Yeah.
You mentioned your son. So in times like this.
My daughter.
Your daughter, sorry. Yeah.
So
the question for the video is, what advice would you give your daughter?
Yes. Yeah, so I actually, in my previous book, thought about that. I actually have two girls, one of whom, my older daughter, actually is the school director for the Khan Academy Lab School in Mountain View, which is on the Google campus. So if you're ever out there and want to visit it. And my younger daughter works for Weekend Edition at National Public Radio. I do have five pieces of advice that I give them. And they're so tired of hearing it, but you're all fresh meat. So I will share it with you. I tell them first, girls, always think like a new immigrant. How does the new immigrant think? New immigrant thinks, I just showed up here in London, and there's no legacy spot waiting for me at the University of London. I better figure out what's going on here, where the opportunities are there, and pursue them with more energy, vigor, and persistence than anybody else. I have an Armenian friend who says, immigrants are actually paranoid optimists. They leave somewhere bad, they think to somewhere better, but they're paranoid, it can be taken away from them in any second. I think we are all new immigrants to the age of acceleration. Second, I tell them, think like an artisan. I got this idea from Larry Katz, who writes on labor at Harvard. Who is the artisan? The artisan was that person in the Middle Ages, before factories, before mass manufacturing, who made every item individually, every item one-off, every chandelier, every shoe, every chair, every table, fork, knife, spoon, cup, saddle, and stirrup, the artisan made individually. And what did the best artisans do? They brought so much human, unique extra to what they did. The best artisans, what do we know? They carved their initials into their work. And you can see it still today. Do your job every day as if you brought so much extra to it that a machine and algorithm could never do, that you want to carve your initials into it at the end of the day. Third, I tell them, this is an idea I got actually from Reid Hoffman at LinkedIn. Basically, always think like a starter-upper in Silicon Valley. So how does the starter-upper think? In Silicon Valley, there's only one four-letter word. It's actually not four letters, but it does begin with an F. That word is finished. If you ever think of yourself as finished, you're likely finished. Reid's motto is always be in beta. Psychologically, always be in beta. I'm about 85% done. Let's throw it over the wall. Let the community test it. Find all the holes. Find the errors. Throw it back. Then we'll throw it over the wall again. Let them test it. His idea is always be in beta. Always be in that state of engineering, re-engineering, and retooling yourself. Never think of yourself as finished. Otherwise, you will really be finished. That's what lifelong learning is all about. Fourth, I tell them, I live by the motto, PQ plus CQ is always greater than IQ. Oh, in the age of Google, if I have a young person who has a high passion quotient and a high curiosity quotient, where the world doesn't care what you know, but what you can do with what you know, I'll take them over the person with high intelligence quotient 7 days a week, 365 days a year. And lastly, always think like a waitress at Perkins Pancake House in Minneapolis, my favorite restaurant. Because when I was working on my previous book, I was out in Minneapolis having breakfast with my best friend, Ken Greer, on a Sunday morning. We went to my favorite restaurant, Perkins, on France Avenue. And I ordered 3 buttermilk pancakes and scrambled eggs. And Ken ordered 3 buttermilk pancakes and fruit. And after 15 minutes, the waitress came. She put our 2 plates down, and all she said to Ken was, I gave you extra fruit. I gave her a 50% tip. Why did I give her a 50% tip? Because that waitress didn't control much, but she controlled the fruit ladle. And that she was back there in the kitchen, and something crept into her mind. She said, I think I'll give this guy a little extra fruit, and we'll just see what happens, okay? And it turns out I was the sucker at the table too, and I was so impressed by that, I gave her a 50% tip. What was that waitress doing? She was thinking entrepreneurially. Whatever you do here at Google Marketing, machine learning, whatever it is, always think entrepreneurially. How can I fork off here and find another market or another opportunity or another business? Why is that so important? Because Ford Motor is not coming to your town with a 25,000 person factory anymore. We need 5 people creating jobs for 10, 10 creating jobs for 20, 8 creating jobs for 30. That's where we're gonna get those 25,000 jobs. You know, I tell the joke in the book about the modern American factory just has 2 employees, a man and a dog. The man is there to feed the dog, and the dog is there to keep the man away from the machines. So we need to all be thinking entrepreneurially. So if you take nothing away from this talk, please take this. Think like an immigrant and stay hungry. Think like an artisan and take pride. Think like a starter upper in Silicon Valley and always be in beta. Remember that PQ plus CQ is always greater than IQ. And always think like a waitress at Perkins Pancake House in Minneapolis and be relentlessly entrepreneurial, because this Minnesota boy can tell you, we actually all do live in Garrison Keillor's Lake Wobegon, where all the women are beautiful and all the men are strong and all the children need to be above average.
With that, we will say thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thomas Friedman.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks for coming.